Welcome. It is Monday, February 27, 2012. I'm Aaron Dykes. Now, coming up later in the program, we have Mike Adams, who hosted the show today. He's got an exclusive interview he did right here on the Nightly News with Patricia Finn. She's a lawyer who's being threatened. They're trying to take away her bar status for protecting her clients who are refusing to vaccinate. And the state and everybody is basically demanding she give up her clients so they can find out who are the parents who refuse to vaccinate their children and why are they trying to stand up for themselves in a legal capacity. She's not backing down. Wait till you see that interview. I'm sure we're going to be hearing more from her. She is a fighter. Now, I'm fresh off the plane just a couple hours ago, back from Orlando. Last night, Alex was at the High Line there in Orlando in affiliation with the big 810 AM station to a sold-out house, packed crowd at the High Line. Very enthusiastic. Alex gave a great speech. We also showed the 40-minute documentary, The New World Order Blueprint of the Mad Men. And, of course, Alex also did his Sunday show there, the two-hour broadcast live on stage as the audience arrived. They all cheered and watched and everything. And it was great. Lots of very excited people, activists all over the crowd. A lot of people very pumped up about liberty, ready to say no to this damn system. And I hope they're as excited about going out there and talking to other people, waking up new minds, as they were about talking to Alex and the crew and all the other great patriots there in attendance. So that was exciting. On the flip side, travel is always its own telling event. Going through the airport here in Austin, Texas, and then in Orlando, Rob Dew and I encountered a special situation as we got off the plane about 2:30 p.m. today here at Austin Bergstrom. And you can see one of these power-tripping TSA minions as they held back perhaps 300 or 400 people, didn't let them pass by for over 5 minutes in this total paranoid episode that we later found out was what they considered a suspicious bag. Naturally, they didn't find anything, but they quarantined the whole zone, and this guy got to put his power on display. A woman in a TSA uniform ran through the crowd, out of the way, out of the way, out of the way, we have a situation. And meanwhile, nothing was even going on. Let's roll some of that footage here now. So Rob Dew is up here with the camera towards the front of the crowd. What you can't see is there's several hundred people behind him. They're not letting people pass through the main walkway or on the sides where they have the seats and the gates over there. Just total lockdown over this paranoia about the bag.
From where I am, over here. Hello.
Nothing actually going on, just freaking out as Austin just put in body scanners, so it's kind of a new level.
TSA action. What a joke.
And so as I was pointing out, they just put in the body scanners now. It's a whole new wave of paranoia there. Everything's a situation now, and they got a lockdown for control, but nothing tangible is even happening. Meanwhile, when something actually does happen, like the underwear bomber turns out of his stage, turns out he was let on the plane. Every time I go through an airport, I always see them flagging handicapped people. Last time I came through Austin, it was a young guy on a cane, and they put him in the isolation box. Meanwhile, you've got all other sectors of travel and hospitality getting more suspicious all the time. You've seen the recent FBI Communities Against Terrorism paranoia flyers where everything, all kinds of activity is potentially terroristic, especially when it has to do with hotels or transportation or rental cars. I had another episode there. It's not caught on camera, but I'll tell you the story briefly. The woman at the rental car place there in Orlando demanded now to know where I was staying and where I was going to be with the car while I had it checked out. And I told her, frankly, it was none of her business. And she was so taken back, she asked me to repeat that twice. She literally didn't process it at first. And then she said, you know, no one has ever told me that in the entire time I've worked for this car company. No one has ever said that's not your business. Everyone apparently just gives up all manner of data as if it's their right to know all these things, as if they don't already have checks in place for things like stolen cars. And she finally admitted, yeah, that's right, it's not my business, but no one's ever bothered to even speak up about that. That's why we have to speak up, people. It does gradually have an effect. You may not see it immediately. Anyway, just a few little anecdotes from our travel and a great event again in Orlando. Alex speaking, of course, well over an hour and a half, very enthusiastic crowd. Turning now to the news, FEMA puts out a contract for emergency camps to house displaced citizens. That's Paul Joseph Watson. And this, again, is just a greater continuation of other reports we've seen recently, including back in December, when memos were leaked, also calling for contractors at camps to be ready to house and staff them within 72 hours in all sectors and capacities. The Federal Emergency Management Agency is looking for contractors to construct temporary emergency camps inside the United States, which can be ready for occupancy within a 72-hour time period and used to house emergency responders as well as displaced citizens. The National Responder Support Camp contract, which was posted on the Federal Business Opportunities website, calls on contractors to provide all necessary supervision, professional staff, labor support, material, supplies, et cetera, within 72 hours, rather, and it would be used to shelter, quote, displaced citizens. And so, again, for well over a decade and a half, you've seen these emergency plans through all the different areas, all the way back to Rex 84, where they're planning for displaced citizens, a mass influx of immigrants. But it always turns out it's just a takeover drill where they suspend the Constitution, put in martial law, and there's a chain of continuity of government command. And this is more of that. We see them really moving to staff those camps and make them totally activated. There's been a lot of points of data. I hope you have been following that with this over the past several months. I'm not going to cover it all today, but in the future, I'm sure we'll recap a lot of it. Meanwhile, the writing is on the wall, and states are beginning to take action. Separately, you've seen a lot of states try to pass bills disputing the NDAA, saying they're not going to take part in the kidnapping of citizens, saying that it's unconstitutional. Now you see this trend where Wyoming is introducing a, quote, doomsday bill to prepare for total collapse and the inability of the federal government to effectively do anything. Legislation lays out plans for alternative currency in the aftermath of a U.S. dollar devaluation. That is, again, Paul Joseph Watson. And the bill lays the groundwork for how the state would respond in the event of a sudden devaluation of the dollar, a situation in which the federal government has no effective power or authority over the people of the United States, and it calls for their own statewide continuity of government plans. And very interesting, as they keep the federal plans secret and states begin to craft their own responses and wonder what's going to happen when less solvent states have mass influx of people going into other places. Well, Wyoming, for one, is batting down the hatches. Also, gas prices signal tsunami of inflation. While places like the UK report an official inflation rate of 3.6%, they're seeing gas prices that equate to $8 a gallon and higher. And it's just one of those things where they will always lie about the real numbers, but you can see it in the economy and things like gas prices. Interesting quote here in the article by Greg Hunter of USA Watchdog. We've had him on before. Inflation is always and everywhere a monetary phenomenon. That's a famous quote from Milton Friedman, the Nobel Prize winning economist. And then that is echoed here again, where they show how the printing through the Federal Reserve and the related mechanisms is what's driving inflation and always has been. You've got Zero Hedge quoted here in the article saying the sole reason why crude prices are surging is because global liquidity has risen by $2 trillion in a few short months on the most epic shadow liquidity tsunami launched in the history in the lieu of QE. Oh, they're sort of on QE3, but they won't exactly admit it. So things continue to deteriorate economically, and we see total preparations for the response after that collapse. So everyone out there has been warned. I hope you're getting ready. I need to do my own preparations as well. Turning to health news, naturalnews.com writer Jonathan Benson reports on the Harvard study citing how pasteurized milk from industrial dairies is linked to cancer. The truth has once again shaken the foundation of the American Tower of Babel, that is mainstream science, with a new study out of Harvard University showing that pasteurized milk products from factory farms are linked to causing hormone-dependent cancers. Turns out the concentrated animal feeding operations model of raising cows on factory farms turns out milk with dangerously high levels of estrone sulfate, an estrogen compound linked to testicular, prostate, and breast cancers. A very familiar meme you see with the GMO foods, you see with the BPA, you see with a lot of stuff. And all the collective wisdom of having these centralized factory farms makes no sense. Meanwhile, raw, grass-fed organic milk from cows milked at the proper times, Jonathan Benson writes, is linked to improving digestion, healing autoimmune disorders, and boosting overall immunity, which helps prevent cancer. And of course, you've got almost all of the essential amino acids in raw milk. If it is harvested in the right way, can be very healthy. I myself enjoy some raw milk when I can get it. Now, turning to more on the GMOs, last week, Alex talked to probably the preeminent GMO expert who covers Monsanto and all the other companies, many of whom congregate around the Bilderberg circles, and it's much worse than we've even previously reported. Jeffrey Smith came back on the program, reconfirmed all the stuff about how genetically modified foods in livestock, in humans, in rat studies is showing triggers of organ failure, it's showing sterility, it's showing infertility, it's showing triggers for cancer. But that's not all, it's also infecting the gut flora, and I won't quote his words directly, I'll let you hear it from him in this clip, but basically taking over the gut flora, where the immune system is located, where digestion occurs, and where so many new autoimmune disorders are located, Crohn's and all the other stuff associated with it, as well as many of the symptoms of autism, now also linked to things like GMO. Let's play the clip now.
When we look at the BT toxin causing these pores or openings in the intestines, there's a whole new field among progressive cutting-edge medical practitioners that are treating or looking at gut permeability. If undigested food through these holes into the blood, that might explain the rise in food allergies, autoimmune disease, inflammation, possibly autism. Because gut permeability is one of the factors that scientists are documenting accompany autism in large numbers. So I was giving a talk
recently. There's also big studies out, just to back you up again, that just came out, that they're finding the GMO DNA and RNA is actually going through the blood and into the cells. They'd always said that was impossible, and Monsanto's come out and said, it's fine to have our DNA in your cells. So it's actually going through now. I think that's more than just gut permeability. It's that, you know, before we are what we eat, and all this stuff that's slowly developed on this planet, we're able to absorb, and it's part of the normal order. You start splicing and crossing and doing all of this, it shows that at a micro level, we're all interchanging at levels we never knew before.
Let's talk about just this gene transfer, because this is one of the scariest things that is currently documented. The only human feeding study ever published verified that part of the gene inserted into soybeans, making those soybeans Roundup ready, unkillable with Roundup, transferred into the DNA of bacteria living inside our intestines. And that bacteria was unkillable with Roundup. So they had Roundup-ready gut bacteria, suggesting that that gene was functioning. Now, pretend that you're eating genetically engineered BT corn chips and the same transfer occurs. What if the gene that produces this toxin that breaks open the stomach of insects and possibly human intestines, what if that gene were to transfer to our own gut bacteria and continue to function? It might turn our living our pesticide, our living intestine, excuse me, it may turn our flora into living pesticide factories. Now, the one of the studies that came out last year gives support for this. In Canada, they tested the blood of 30 pregnant women and their unborn fetuses and found in 93% of the pregnant women, the BT toxin was in their blood and in the blood of 80% of the cord blood of their unborn fetuses. So what this means is that somehow the BT toxin is getting into the bloodstream, and this is not supposed to happen according to the EPA. According to the EPA, it's supposed to be destroyed during digestion. So the authors were wondering, how come the frequency is so high? We don't eat that much corn chips and fresh corn to justify that. So they expected that it was the eating the meat and dairy from animals that have been fed Monsanto's corn, which was the source of the BT toxin. But I think it's more likely that it was the transformation of the gut bacteria inside the intestines of North Americans, which is causing this high constant exposure. And when I talk about this to medical conferences where I speak all the time, doctors invariably tell me that the rise in gastrointestinal problems has been astronomical. Irritable bowel syndrome, for example, is up 40% since GMOs were introduced.
And this is so bombshell. I asked the guys to pull this clip. A lot of you already heard this interview last week. Go back and watch it again. Share it with everyone. This stuff is epidemic. I talked to Mike Adams about today. He straight up said we're being euthanized. This is a big, big deal. Let's just recap some of what he just said, Jeffrey Smith, in this interview. He said the Roundup Ready was taking over in the gut bacteria. It suggested it was a still-functioning gene. You could call it what you want. It's compatible with the total alien takeover of our body. And he commented that it appears our flora are becoming a living pesticide factory inside the womb. What is that going to do to us? It's not just the 90% of corn, the 90% of soy, and the other crops. As he pointed out, it's the animals eating this stuff that we then eat. Goes totally through the food chain. Meanwhile, the actual pesticides and the genes in there appear to be functioning, permeating the gut bacteria. This is huge. People need to look more and more into this. And then Alex brought up later in the interview how we had also come across the Bill Gates Foundation doing a lot of research on the gut flora in connection with vaccines. Now, that's very interesting because Bill Gates has come out way out, called people like Dr. Andrew Wakefield a fraud for investigating the connection between vaccines and autism, for investigating autistic children and finding this pattern of abuse in the actual gut flora of the body. Again, an entirely critical center of the body, 10 times more cell in that digestive tract area than in the whole rest of the body. It is crucial we all begin looking at this. And the idea that there's a connection not only between certain types of vaccines, at least alleged and investigated, as well as the genetically modified foods, really continues to tie back to Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, because they're the number one people monetarily and ideologically pushing both vaccines and GMO across the world, forcing them on everyone. And ever since 2009, investigating gut flora phenomenons and the inability of vaccines to work in the third world with children who have kind of underdeveloped immune systems and the rest of it has been a major priority. It was named one of their top grand challenges. You can go back and read the grants. I'll read you just a couple headlines now so you have a point of reference and you can find the stuff for yourself. We all have to do more research on this. This isn't going to go away. It's going to be a problem. Now, you've got NBC 29 in March 25th of 2011. UVA receives $14.7 million grant from the Gates Foundation to investigate children whose bodies reject the protection they desperately need from diseases that comes in the form of vaccine, and goes on to discuss how they will measure the role of the intestinal bacterial flora or microbiome and the impact of intestinal damage in response to vaccines. Canadian researchers win Gates grants from some weird science. That's in the Globe and Mail. Talks about numerous projects they're investigating, including one on the gut flora. Dina Gibson and Sanjoy Ghosh of the University of British Columbia seek to determine whether improving a pregnant woman's diet ensures her baby has a healthy microflora in its gut to protect it from diseases later in life. Again, you've got to read between the lines. Why are we having this gut flora phenomenon and they're doing all this research? They're not going to tell you anything other than that they're good people trying to help everyone, but we must read between the lines. Now you've got Gates Foundation's new grant for biomarkers of gastrointestinal gut function and health. You've got the hidden epidemic destroying your gut flora by Dr. Merkula, and a whole lot more. There were dozens and dozens of grants that they gave out in regard to vaccine and gut flora investigation, and they also push GMOs like no one else. Their idea is to genetically modify the Plasmodium berigal parasite so it will activate and teach the human immune system to fight malaria parasite. In another article, Gates Foundation awarded to scientists in Portugal for their innovative research in malaria, and again brings up the risk of vaccine itself in inducing malaria and other ideas about the immune system and the gut flora. So they're into that. That's a fact. It's on record. Look it up for yourself. Do your own coverage. I can't really do it justice. Meanwhile, GMOs are being pushed on the whole world. Our great researcher, Marcos, who also does a lot of the graphics, dug this out from a couple years ago. Mutant seeds for Mesopotamia. How there's a totally corporate new non-constitution for Iraq and the occupation there known as the 100 Orders. And it out and out is for corporate dominance of Iraq. I'm sure they're doing this in other countries as well, just as they do through the IMF and other entities. It has things like tax-free remittance for all corporate profits and other laws to ensure that foreign contractors and private security firms have immunity from Iraq's laws. That's just a few pieces from the 100 orders. But the worst of all, back to one of the most blatant orders of all, Order 81. Under this mandate, Iraq's commercial farmers must now buy, quote, registered seeds. They're normally imported by Monsanto, Cargill, and the Worldwide Wheat Company. Unfortunately, these registered seeds are terminator seeds, meaning sterile. Imagine if the human men were all infertile, and in order to reproduce, women needed to buy sperm cells at the sperm bank. In agricultural terms, terminator seeds represent the same kind of sterility. And it goes on to discuss how there's the whole history of Mesopotamia, a minimum of 4,000 years of seed trading and just organically developing the different varieties of crops there. How it even really goes back 8,000 years B.C. in that cradle, the Fertile Crescent, and all that stuff. And how, well, now some genius company is just going to force all these mono variety seeds on Iraq, and that the farmers will have to buy it. It's going to devastate their agriculture, just as it has in India, as is currently underway in Africa, as it's happening in South America, as it's happening in North America. And Europe has fought back, but it's happening there too. And why not? Because you got articles like the one we covered a couple weeks ago in the New York Times, where We the People is losing appeal with people around the world. And basically how the Constitution and Bill of Rights are somehow not good enough anymore, trying to sell people on the idea of their own enslavement as they bring to full bore into the light the corporate governance system under the world government. And again, it's not just the United Nations that's one organ of this larger world government. You've got these major foundations. Used to be the Rockefeller Foundation was number one. Increasingly, the Gates Foundation is becoming the number one foundation, even though it's totally interlocked with the Rockefeller Foundation. And they drive this global governance. They make recommendations to governments around the world at the national level. They implement policies at the global level. And they privately fund things they can't get done through government. So they have incredible influence. It's very scary the way they're changing this world. We all have to wake up to this. And now's the time to fight back, if ever. Turning now to our daily quote. And of course, we're coming back with that crucial interview with Mike Adams, with the lawyer who is protecting her clients as they try to come after parents who refuse to vaccinate. That is Patricia Finn. That's coming up just after the break. Turn now to our daily quote. Competition is a great thing. No, competition's a sin. That's John D. Rockefeller as they began the super vertical horizontal global integration of all business and industry under the larger Illuminati bloodline type families who had already seized a lot of control in the Anglo world. And it went supernova under the Rockefellers and all the things they did through their so-called charitable work. But guess what? Philanthropy is not charity, and they really don't want competition. That should be a message to everyone. Thanks for watching, and Mike Adams coming up with that hard-hitting interview, and we'll have more for you tomorrow. Thanks.
get out of the comfort zone, because these people aren't playing games.
9/11 was an inside job. 9/11 was an inside job.
We're going to organize. Humanity's going to come together. We are swinging muskets here, toe-to-toe with the globalists. They're bloodied. We're bloodied. It is absolute total war. Signing these evil 1776 flags. Doesn't get any more out of control than that, ladies and gentlemen. It's pretty un-American what we're doing here at Infowars.com. I mean, not only are we promoting liberty, but we're selling 1776 flags. Now that is Al-Qaeda.
Continuing with Infowars Nightly News, this is Mike Adams, the Health Ranger, jumping in to interview Patty Finn. She is an attorney who is being, you might say, terrorized, certainly suppressed, because she represents parents who are trying to defend parental freedom when it comes to the vaccination issue. And now the legal establishment in New York, where she practices, is demanding that she turn over all the names of all of her clients that she represents, which would expose, of course, all those parents to state authorities, which could result in those children being taken away, kidnapped by Child Protective Services. This is a violation of basic human rights. This is a violation of law, I believe. But we'll find out more as we talk with Patty Finn, who joins us now for Infowars Nightly News. Patty, thank you for joining us this evening. It's great to have you on.
Thank you. Thank you.
Can you give us the breakdown of this situation? How did it start, and what are they demanding from you right now?
Well, this problem began in 2009 during a very high-profile case that I handled here in New York involving the H1N1 mandate. New York State healthcare workers under an emergency regulation were told either they inject H1N1 or they lose their jobs. I was a pretty unknown attorney at that time, and being here in New York and, you know, media frenzy, et cetera, I, you know, became somewhat of a media figure on this subject. At that time, I had two complaints filed against me by clients, and a doctor, a pediatrician here in New York, filed a complaint against me when I had written to him to advise him that, you know, parents don't have to get vaccines, that in New York you can get a statutory exemption. And these were minor irregularities. It had nothing to do with escrow money. It was advertising and, you know, some other very, very minor things. And any other lawyer would have written a letter and answered it, and it would have gone away. But when I wrote my answer, I was accused of lying. And then more charges were filed against me.
So is it fair to say that they seem to be coming after you, not because of the way you're practicing law, but because of the substance of those cases that you take on, in particular, vaccines, parental freedom, health freedom?
Well, you know, it is easy to draw that conclusion, particularly given the timing of these charges. You know, I was served on a Friday night before I left to attend this West Virginia rally on parental rights. And, you know, it's kind of odd that they waited till my office was closed and then to try to serve me with something and suspend my license. You know, do I really know what is motivating them? No, because a lot of these proceedings are secret. I don't know what is being discussed. I do know that the investigating attorney, when she met me, did tell me that she didn't like my tone. And the only tone that I'm sure she was aware of was that in the media with the H1N1 and perhaps something that I had written. And, you know, it's just endless. You know, even if it wasn't about vaccines, it's still the harassment's been endless. Every time, or most times, when I answered something, I was brought up on more charges for lying.
Well, let me get to the substance of the harassment here. I have a letter in my hand from the state of New York signed by Gary Casella, chief counsel of the 9th Judicial District, and he demands a written answer from you to the allegations contained herein, and that your answer should include a detailed list of all of your firm's current clients, including their docket numbers and copies of all their cases. Isn't that a violation of basic attorney-client privilege?
Yes, and quite possibly a violation of HIPAA and my client's First Amendment rights to the free exercise of religion. I mean, a lot of the people that I represent don't vaccinate because of their religious beliefs. So it is unusual, but what's important here is that this is the second time I've been charged with this. In 2009, a pediatrician here in New York filed a complaint saying that my work was designed to assist people to subvert the law and that it could actually be a public health risk. And when I answered that complaint, I was not charged with that, but I was charged with an advertising violation that sought the same information that is being requested now. And when I did not provide that information, I was admonished, I objected, and when I objected, I said I was going to appeal. And as I was leaving the secret types of meetings that are held, or the let me be clear, the closed doors meetings,
yes.
I was followed to the door, and I was told that if I appealed, I would be brought up on higher charges, which, you know, is also very questionable, because what else, you know, are they holding back on me, you know, or something? I don't really know. You know, it's really a scary thing, and I am quite upset about it, but I had no choice but to go public.
Let me get to some other language that's contained in this complaint against you. They have a finding. They say, upon a finding that the respondent is guilty of misconduct immediately threatening the public interest. Now, this is based on the assumption that vaccinations are the one and only way, you know, granted by God to protect public health. Now, that is provably false, so there's a lot of scientific fraud behind that, but this reasoning that they can do anything they want to you, they can violate attorney-client privilege, they can take away your license to practice law, they can harass you because you don't comply with their distorted definition of what is in the public interest, this strikes me as egregious and very scary in a society that's supposed to be ruled by law.
Well, you know, what's happening here is that I was admonished in 2009 on these complaints that were very, very mild, and I had provided, I mean, that's a really harsh sanction. And I provided evidence to the contrary to basically all of the allegations, you know, and so they found me liable of violating these ethical codes. I chose not to appeal them because I was afraid. And now the harassment continued, and I brought another lawsuit to try to stop the harassment because one of the complaints was time barred by the statute of limitations. You know, you don't have to go to law school to know about, any parent with autism knows about the statute of limitations. And because I, an attorney, filed a lawsuit to protect my rights regarding a decision that was incorrect, I'm now being charged with violating yet another admonishment. So it's a constant snowballing, and it's starting to get twisted and
right.
perverted. And, you know, and of course, people are so quick to judge attorneys in particular, and they're very harsh. But, you know, I'm quite clear that I've done absolutely nothing wrong. And if I did do something wrong, it was exceptionally minor. And it's just this snowballing effect and harassment and intimidation.
Well, and it seems that this judicial district has taken the position that anything that big government says is correct for public health, that if you defend someone to opt out of that, then you're evil. So if the government said that all children should be bloodletted, that you should take half a pint of blood from your child every evening because that's great for their health, and you defended parents to say maybe we shouldn't take blood from our children, you would be harassed for the same thing we're seeing here because the government says bloodletting is good for children. I mean, there's no sense to it.
Well, you know, as I had stated previously, I don't know what is in the minds of those individuals reviewing my record and picking apart my life and my practice. I do know that these charges against me were bogus and ridiculous. And I know that when I defended them, the evidence I provided was overlooked. When I wanted to appeal, I was harassed. Then I filed a lawsuit finally to stop the harassment, and now I'm being charged with violating the underlying admonishments. The issue, though, I think that is scary here is that the advertising claim, you know, my activity on the internet is obviously being monitored.
Right.
Because someone from the grievance committee went to my website, found this statement, and is now trying to charge me with violating making the statement 3 years ago. 3 years ago, I wouldn't give up the kids' names, and I'm not giving them up now. And I don't know why they're harassing me, other than I do know that they told me they don't like my tone. And I find that, you know, I have a right of speech. I have a right of inflection in my speech.
Well, let's talk about what can the viewing public, the InfoWars fans out there, do to help support your cause here? Is there a website they can go to? Is there a letter they can write to someone? What kind of action can help support you?
Well, you know, that's interesting. I would ask that, you know, people do go to my wall, Patricia Finn Attorney, and, you know, kind of stay close.
Is that a .com, Patricia Finn Attorney?
No, on Facebook. You can go
on Facebook.
To Patricia Finn Attorney. And that would, you know, you can certainly watch what's being posted and what's being said. As for writing letters on my behalf, I don't, as an officer of the court, would not encourage anybody to deluge the court or, you know, or the grievance committee with letters, although people are free to do whatever they want. And I was certainly free to take this to the press. I don't think any lawyer probably that I know of has ever done something like this. But Mike, I have to tell you, you know, practicing law is a joke. I make absolutely no money whatsoever, and they want to now come and take my license from me. You know what? They can have it. The work that I've done, so much of it is pro bono. They make me look like I'm some fat cat here taking advantage of people, and it's completely not true. I have lawyers working for me. They haven't been paid in months, and we still come to work, and the harassment is endless.
Well, we know they will twist reality to tell their narrative, their false narrative, in whatever way they want. In fact, I would say that you're being victimized as part of what we call the Wakefield effect, referring to Dr. Andrew Wakefield, who had his medical license stripped away when he began to really ask scientific questions about the links between vaccines and the health effects in children. And then others have said, well, there's a link between vaccines and autism, for example. That wasn't Wakefield who actually said that, but then he is smeared in the media as saying that Wakefield said vaccines cause autism, and they use that disinformation, completely lying about him, to take away his license. It looks like they're attempting to do similar things to you.
It's endless, the harassment. I've been accused of lying over and over again. I was accused of ducking the FedEx guy when a package was supposedly delivered here. When I said I was out of town, I was actually in West Virginia. I had to provide airline tickets showing where I was. I had to provide a floor plan to show where I sit in relation to the door. Yeah, because I was accused of being here when the FedEx man came. I mean, it's just ridiculous, you know. And if it was any other attorney that fell in the line or was part of the old boy network, my explanations that I provided would have solved this matter. And they weren't. It's so outrageous. I have no choice. I don't care anymore, you know. I mean,
yeah.
I do care about the children. And if I have to lose my license to elevate this issue, then that's my destiny. I mean, well, I don't think I will, because, you know, I'm hoping that I'm going to get in front of a judge that's finally going to take a look at this and say, hey, what, you know, what the heck is going on?
Right. You'll have plenty of support, by the way.
I'm saying
you'll have plenty of support in the alternative media, the real media, like Infowars Nightly News. That's where the real news gets reported. You can't expect a fair coverage in the hoax prostitute press, or the prostitutes, as we sometimes say out there. Just like Wakefield did not get a fair shake out there. Any final thoughts in closing?
Yes, when I talked to Wakefield, I watched in horror as he was picked apart, and it was awful what happened to him. And I can tell you that I'm going through exactly the same thing. You know, I'm a good woman. I'm a moral woman. I work hard. I've helped thousands of people with their rights to avoid vaccinations, and I'm being barred admission to the Supreme Court because I'm accused of not stamping an envelope with the words attorney advertising when it wasn't even in my opinion an advertisement. It was a letter to a doctor. So
well, it also strikes me as odd that the highest attorney in our nation, attorney Eric Holder, Attorney General Eric Holder. You know, he's involved in running guns into Mexico, illegal firearms crossing the border as part of a false flag scheme to blame the Second Amendment. I mean, you've got high-level attorneys throughout Washington who are committing crimes, who are pedophiles, who are raping children, who are violating the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, who are taking bribery money, who are just violating every ethical standard of practicing law, and then they come after you? For this?
A housewife from New York, you know.
It's incredible.
It is incredible, and I'm done. Gloves are off, you know, and I'm going to go to the appellate division, and I'm going to get in front of a judge, and I'm going to show him what I have been subjected to because, you know, I faxed the letter instead of mailing it, or I didn't write attorney advertising on an envelope. It's ridiculous. I cannot argue these cases in the Supreme Court of the United States because of this harassment. And that's really what has brought me to the media. I'm done. I am the one that I should be bringing this case before the court. And
yes.
I will. I will indeed.
Well, please continue to speak out. We love your attitude, Patricia. We want to wish you our love and our support in your endeavor to speak the truth and stand up for these children who are being harmed by vaccines, or at least we should say that the parents should have the right to choose whether they wish to expose their children to these vaccines, many of which are linked to seizures and some linked to death. So, you know, you are really an American hero, and I appreciate what you're doing.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Patricia. Good to have you on InfoWars Nightly News. All right, folks, that was the interview with Patricia Finn. Check out her Facebook page at Patricia Finn Attorney. And stay in touch with her activities. We'll be covering her continued coverage here on Infowars.com. Perhaps Alex will talk to her down the road. We'll let him decide. But this is a very important story. So stay tuned in on what the outcome is. We will continue to fight for her free speech rights and the right to represent parents who are trying to protect their children from the dangers of vaccines. Thank you.